Today we get to focus on the resurrection once again, and that makes me happy. I love talking about the victory of Christ.
Yes.
Because, oh, it is victory.
Yes.
Not just for him, but for you and I.
Amen.
Not just for him. Getting who Jesus really is. And it's something, and I put it just like that, it's something that we need to get.
Yes.
And as I look around, you all would probably say, I know who Jesus is. Do you? I hope that we get it. I'll start by asking the question. Who is Jesus? And people say a lot of different things. Some will say he's a great teacher. He was a great teacher. He was a prophet. He was this and that. Jesus even asked his own disciples the same question. It says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? And he's speaking about himself. He refers to himself as the Son of Man. They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But what about you, he asked. See, this is where he makes it personal. Who do you say I am? And nobody said anything, but then Peter piped up. Okay? There with the 12. I wonder why it was just Peter who spoke up. Just one out of 12. Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Which was the right answer. And Jesus commended him. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. For this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. Jesus is the Christ.
Yes.
And I think it's kind of telling that Jesus asked this to a crowd of 12 people, his 12 disciples. And only really got one answer. I bring this word because I want our eyes to be open on this Resurrection Sunday as to who he really is.
Yes.
Or as the Apostle Paul would say, I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. Why? In order that you may know the hope to which he has called you. The riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. See, that's a part of who he is. We have this great inheritance in the saints. We inherit heaven. We inherit the Lord himself. We inherit the power of God. We inherit eternal life. There is much to this. And I love how he wraps it up. And his incomparably great power. His incomparably great power for us who believe. Now, when it comes to who Jesus is, not everybody gets it. Heaven gets it. And we see in heaven, one of my favorite passages out of the book of the Revelation, Revelation chapter 7. It says, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb. And they were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. Again, this is a part of John's vision as he was taken to heaven and shown these things. In their hands. And they cried out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, amen. And we were looking at that word amen this last week. Amen, y'all know what amen means? It means truth. Truth. Mm-hmm. Or they fell out on their faces and say, yes, this is true. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Truth. Yeah, heaven gets it. We have all of these scenes in the book of Revelation where they're praising the Lord and blessing his name, and they sang a new song and worship to the Lord. You worship. Heaven gets it. Yes, Lord. Hell gets it too. Mm-hmm. You know, I was thinking of that story where Jesus cast out demons from the Gadarene demoniac. You know what I'm talking about? In the vicinity of the Gadarenes, there was a man who was full of demons. Well, let me give it to you. It's in a number of the Gospels. I'll give it to you out of Luke chapter 8. Jesus was on the boat with his disciples. They came to the shore. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. And the town was Gadara. For a long time, this man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. When he saw Jesus, now get that. When he saw Jesus, he cried out and fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice, what do you want with me, Jesus? Son of the Most High God, I beg you, don't torture me. Now, as the story goes on, Jesus asks this guy, asks this man, what is your name? Yeah, he's speaking to the demon. And the demon said, Legion, for we are many. Now, he used the word legion. A legion of Roman soldiers was at least 1,000. And as the story goes on, there were a large herd of swine there. And Jesus let them go into the swine because they asked. And the pigs ran down into the water and drowned themselves. That's how the story goes. The part that I want you to get is that the demons knew who Jesus was. They spotted him. It didn't say that when Jesus stepped ashore, he saw this guy full of demons and said, "Hey, you guy full of demons." He didn't scout it out that way. They saw him. And it says they ran and fell at his feet. Okay? That is a position of worship. And in this case, it was a position of worship and begging for mercy. Woo! Begging for mercy. What do you want with me? Don't torture me. Some of the other gospels say, they ask, "Have you come to torment us before the time?" They know that there is no hope for them. And hell is their only place to go. Heaven forgets who he is. James says, as he's trying to explain that faith without works is dead, is useless. He says, "You said you believe, though, that's good. Demons believe and shudder." Okay, the demons believe and tremble. Okay, and that word tremble in the Greek means to have your skin crawl and the hair stand up on your arms. That horror, that sense of horror. Demons believe and go through that in the name of Jesus. Heaven gets it, hell gets it. But Jesus' disciples didn't get it. You know? They didn't get it. They didn't get who Jesus was, although they had been with him for a long time. When Jesus started his public ministry, basically it was for 3.5 years. His disciples had been with him for a while. And they saw him do many miracles, or rather than say miracles, I would say demonstrations of authority. Okay? And I want you all to see it that way, and I've spoken to this before, that although Jesus did miracles, I prefer to refer to them as demonstrations of authority, because he was showing his authority as to who he was. He came a speaking authoritative. Okay? And he acted authoritatively to back up the fact that his words were not just words. Okay? One of his disciples, they heard his teachings, and they saw Jesus raise Lazarus' daughter from the Lazarus from the dead. Okay? They were there in the village of Bethany. They saw Jesus raise Jairus' daughter, his little girl, from the dead. Took the little dead girl by the hand and said, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." They saw Jesus raise the widow's son from the dead. And that was a funeral procession. A funeral funeral going by, they stopped, the funeral procession and raised the dead guy up. They saw Jesus cleanse the lepers. They saw him, open blind eyes. They saw him at his first public miracle. He turned water into wine. He turned 120 to 180 gallons of water into 120 to 180 gallons of fine wine. They saw food multiplied and the lame heal. And again, I mentioned the idea of blinded eyes open. They saw Jesus walk on the water. Walk on the water.
Yes.
Okay. And there was no, it was not a magician's trick. Bible says that he told them, you guys get in the boat and go on over to the other side. And he stayed back and prayed. They got in the boat and it says, when they were about 3 to 3.5 miles out, Jesus came walking to them on the water. 3 to 3.5 miles. Yet they believed. Now this is what I want you to see. They believed in him. They understood that he was the Christ. Just like we do. We believe in him. We understand that he's the Christ. But yet they still didn't get it. That's the wild part. They still didn't get it. You know, how do you know that they didn't get it by then, Pastor Bill? Well, because of what I'm about to give you in just a second. But let me say this. When you start to see who Jesus really is, it might scare you.
Yes.
Okay? Yeah. It might scare you. Well, people say, I don't believe there is a God. Why do you say that? Well, I can't see him. Where is he? It's God's mercy that keeps you from seeing. If you saw him, it would kill you.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
God told Moses, no man can see my face and live. Yes, Lord. When you start to get a glimpse of who he is, it might scare you. That's what happened to his disciples. They had been with him through all this stuff. They started to get a glimpse. They caught a glimpse of who he was. And were terrified. The Bible says they were terrified. You know the story about how Jesus calmed the waters. You know, they were all out there in the Sea of Galilee. And a big storm came up. A big demonically inspired storm came up. And the water was coming into the boat, big waves splashing over the edge of the boat. They were trying to bail water out of the boat. Jesus is in the back of the boat, asleep on a cushion, taking a nap. And they woke him up. Jesus, we're about to drown out here. Don't you care that we're about to perish? It says, Jesus got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, quiet, be still. Now, don't miss this. That's two short little commands. One to the wind, one to the waves. The wind blowing all that noise. shh, you know, the noise of a storm way out there in the sea? Quiet. The sea that had the boat jumping up and down, water splashing into the boat. Be still. The wind died down and it was completely calm. And he said to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? Look what Jesus said. You guys don't get it. You still have no faith. Lord, help us have faith.
Yes.
Lord, help us get it.
Yes.
The next verse. Look at that. They were terrified. I love those words. They were terrified. Now, wait a minute, fellas. The storm is over. The wind's not blowing. The sea is nice and calm. What were they terrified of? Yeah. They were terrified of Jesus. First, they were frustrated with him. We about to drown out here. You back there sleeping? Wake up! We need some help here. Everybody ever been there?
Yep.
Lord, I'm going under. Where are you? And look at that question. All the guys who've been with him for all this time and seeing all the miracles and what have you and preaching in his name and tell, oh yes, he's the Christ, we found the Messiah. Amen. They looked at Jesus in terror and said, who is this? That even the winds and the waves obey.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. They caught a glimpse of who he was.
Amen.
And it's scary. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. They caught a glimpse. The Apostle John wrote the book of Revelation. And one thing I said, I want to tell you before I give you that thing is, as the disciples were terrified, Jesus had just blown their mind. And if you get a glimpse of him, understand who he is, he will glorify. You see, the infinite Christ is far beyond who you think he is with your finite mind. You can't figure him out. You know, I know and love many people who are atheists. And they're trying to figure God out, and they can't add it up all up in their minds, and they refuse to. You'll never figure out just who he is with your finite mind. You know, Jesus had one disciple who was his favorite. Okay, and it was quite evident that he was Jesus' favorite. It was John. The Apostle John, they referred to him as the one that Jesus loved. Now, Jesus loved them all. Okay, but he was especially fond of John. Now, John wrote the book of Revelation, and he got a glimpse, he got to see the risen Christ in his glorified form. Jesus appeared to him in his vision when John was taken to heaven. And John said, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, 'Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys to death and hell, death and Hades.'" Two things I want you to get there. This was Jesus appearing to the disciple he loved. And but yet Jesus had to identify himself. And look how he did identify himself. The qualifier that he gave to John, "I'm the guy who rose. I was dead and now I'm alive forevermore." Jesus defined himself to John by the resurrection. I want you to get that. And one of the things I'm seeing here is that after the resurrection, they became firm believers, the disciples. They became firm believers. See, when you get who he is, it will change your life.
Yes,
it will. Now, the disciples who had seen Jesus rise and they were with him for 40 days, when Jesus rose from the dead, it says there in the first chapter of Acts that he was with his disciples for teaching them for 40 days as the risen Christ. And then he ascended. Okay? So, they had been with him for those 40 days, receiving that teaching. They understood firmly that he was alive. And that changed their lives to the point where, as they became firm believers, they became people who would willingly die for their testimony. Now, before Jesus rose, before he was crucified, Jesus was telling them repeatedly, "I'm going to go to Jerusalem and I'm going to be arrested and crucified, you know, and 3 days later I'll rise again." And they said, "Yep, okay." And then went in one ear out the other. They didn't believe it. And they said, "We're with you, Lord. We're going to hang tough with you." And Jesus said, "You guys, when they strike the shepherd, the sheep will scatter." Jesus said, they said, no, we're with you. Nothing can drive us away. Peter said, These other 11 over here, I don't care if they do run. I ain't going nowhere. Me and you. I'm going to hang tougher than anybody." Jesus said, "By the time the rooster crows a couple times, you have denied me 3 times. And they went from that to being to being firm believers. When they arrested Jesus, all those guys ran. They all ran. Okay? Everybody ran. to being those who really were firm in their belief to the place where they were willing to die for their testimony. As a matter of fact, out of the 11 disciples, out of the 12 disciples, 11 of them were martyred for their faith. Okay? The first 12 apostles, 11 of them were, that's how they died, as martyrs. They were killed for their faith. Some of them were crucified, Peter was crucified upside down, some were thrown off of tall places. One was dragged through the city with horses, dragged to death, that sort of thing. I said 11 out of 12. The 12th one who did not die as a martyr was John the Beloved. He's the only one who died as an old man. And they tried to kill him. They put him through a lot of torture stuff, including boiling him in oil. And he didn't die. So they shipped him off to the prison island of Patmos, where he had the vision, the revelation. But none of them had it easy. And it's because they got it. They got it. And as I wrap this up, Paul says in Colossians 1, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of the saints, the kingdom of God. Let me get that sentence again. Who has qualified you, to share in the inheritance of the saints in the kingdom of light. Now, this is some of the stuff that Christ's resurrection has bought for us. That you are called the saints. And we are on our way to the kingdom of light. If you get it, you'll understand that. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness.
Yes. Thank the Lord.
And brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves.
Yes.
In whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sin.
Amen.
Verse 13. He has rescued us from the dominion of darkness.
Yes. Amen.
And brought us into the kingdom of the Son he loves. Rescued us from the hellhound.
Yes.
And brought us into the kingdom.
Yes.
See, when you get who he is, again, you'll understand that you're one of the saints on his and her way to the kingdom of light. And when you get who he is, listen, you'll stop playing with the darkness of sin that you have been rescued from.
Yes.
Okay, because what have you been rescued from? The dominion of darkness, whose goal is to drag you to hell. When you get it, you'll start walking in greater victory in your personal life.
Yes.
Why? Because you understand you're one of the saints mm-hmm. on his or her way to the kingdom of life. There's so much for us
yes.
when we get it.
Yes.
It speaks of his incomparably great power to us who believe, to us who get it. To us who get who he is.
Yes.
He is the Lord. I wish I had more time. I want you all to read all of Colossians 1 that tells you who Jesus is. He is the firstborn from the dead. That means he was the first to rise and never, ever, ever die again. Okay? Lazarus, he raised Lazarus from the dead. People had been raised from the dead before Jesus. In the Old Testament, Elijah the prophet was raised with the woman's son back to life. Yeah. Jesus raised Lazarus, but Lazarus died again. All these people who got raised from the dead, they didn't stay alive forever and ever. So, let me ask this question. That's my last slide. Are you a follower of Christ? A follower of Christ. And I like that term better than the term Christian. Because in our culture, the word Christian has been muddied. People have weird ideas about what Christian. Some of it is because Christians have set a bad example. A lot of it is because Christians have been demonized by people who are against Christ. People feel free to make fun of Christ. If you go to Google, look up Google Images, where they just show you pictures, and type in Jesus Christ, and see how many pictures you get making fun of him. That's amazing. They don't get it. And there are people who oppose him. And they oppose those who call themselves Christians. I like the word Christ follower, those words, because I'm following him. I'm not just believing in him, Lord. I'm saying, as I'm preaching this about you, you get it. Lord, help me always, help me to get it.
Yes.
More and more and more and more.
Yes.
Help me to get it. Because there are people in this world around us, people in our lives, who need us to get it.
Yes.
Okay, they need him to blow through all the static that they have to filter through trying to find out who God is. They need you to help them understand that he's not just some teacher from 2000. That he's the Lord.
Amen.
He's just not a prophet. Just not some good guy. I've heard a lot of people say that they thought Jesus and Satan were brothers. I'm serious. That is a popular and a satanic teaching. That they are equals. But God the Father loved Jesus, loved his one brother more. And that's not the truth. No way are they equal. Satan is, Jesus is God, the Creator, and Satan is one of the created beings. Anyway, are you a Christ follower? Listen. If you're not following him, if you're not following him, your sins are not forgiven. And you're still under the cruel bonds of the dominion of darkness. And God wants to reassign destinies to them.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
To, because you weren't walking with God, your destiny was ruined. When we start walking with God, our destiny becomes reassigned. We go from ruin to the riches of the glory of God.
Yes.
Yes. And I'm not saying that God will make you rich. Don't misunderstand what I just said. If God makes you rich, so be it. Lord bless you and tithe, please. But I'm talking about the riches of the kingdom.
Yes.
Are you following Christ, but on a level that lacks depth? Be empowered by His Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Let's pray right now. If you've not submitted your life to Jesus, if you're not following Christ, you're here in church today because you have a religious belief. But if you're not following Him, and you're still playing with the sins that He died to save you from, pray this with me now. Lord, forgive me for my sins and come into my life. Forgive me for my sins, O God, and make me yours. Grant me eternal life. Give me your salvation right now. Because I believe who you are and that you are the Christ, the risen Christ, who died on the cross for my sins and rose again on the third day. Provide salvation for us all, for all eternity. And I pray this in Jesus' name. And Father, Lord, for all the rest of us, Lord, empower us with your Holy Spirit. Help us to live the life, to follow closely, to follow truly. To follow in deed and not just in word. Lord, we need you. We don't want to be those, Lord, who are a mile wide and an inch deep. We want depth to our walks, God. Empower us, O God. Lord, give us the boldness. Open our eyes, Lord. Indeed, as Paul says, I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. Open our eyes that we might see. Help us understand who you are and all the great benefits of your resurrection for us. Thank you, Lord. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.